This video contains elements that are not suitable for children under the age of 14. Viewer discretion is advised. Hey guys, Sean Fay-Wolfe of Dime Deck Studios Music here, and 2016 sucked. Yes, even in the best list I feel compelled to say that. Crashing, hit a wall. You may recall me saying in my worst list that I felt the critics were a bit too hard on 2016, but this is being said through the 2020 lens of hindsight. I distinctly remember a single day in November of 2016 when I looked at the 2016 year-end list, and without having looked at a single other critic's opinion, I worked out for myself that 2016 was one of the worst years for music ever. I remember being overwhelmed with passionate disgust. And that moment was when I decided that I wanted to start my own YouTube channel, because I had to share these thoughts with somebody. Granted, I was still shy and awkward, and I had no idea how to film or edit anything, but I still had that desire, and eventually I did decide to stop stalling and go for it, resulting in the birth of Diamond Axe Studios Music. So, in a weird way, if it weren't for how bad the music of 2016 was, I might not be talking to you guys right now. And also, now that I've honed my critical capabilities over the past 9 months, I've looked back at 2016 and found that when you uncouple the songs from the bleakness of the year they were released in, much of 2016's year-end list actually stacks up pretty favorably compared to other years. Unlike the 2007 list, where I had to stretch a bit to put in songs I actually liked, I genuinely adore every song on this list, and I even had to make some pretty painful cuts. So let's prove once and for all that the year that was so bad that it made me want to start reviewing music was actually not that bad at all, which means that my judgment was wrong and that I'm actually a shitty music critic. God, this is self-defeating. And if you like, then I drive it with the windows down. And if you like, go in places we can't even pronounce. If you like to do whatever you've been dreaming about. Maybe you're perfect. Maybe you're perfect. So let's try right now. So, do you remember in my worst list when I said that sometimes in the pop world, strange, bizarre, and unexplainable things happen where you just have to roll with it without thinking about it too hard? Well, you see, the thing is, in 2016, that Future ripoff who made that Panda song released a horrorcore trap song about the main character of the Fairly Odd Parents going on a killing spree with a lyric video that had these fucking things in it. But, the craziest part about all of this is, that song, the one that I was describing just now, it's actually really good. I am so astounded that this song managed to make the year-end list, even if it was just, you know, three places away from getting cut. I mean, I realized Designer's single right before this one was a number one hit, but let's be real, Panda isn't the type of song that makes you even remotely interested in the artist who made it, and that's coming from someone who doesn't dislike Panda at all. It was instantly obvious to everybody the second they heard him that Designer was just another Future ripoff who just so happened to release a song with just the right combination of beat, catchiness, and simplicity to reach the top of the charts. However, when he released a new song named after everybody's favorite, Average Kid, and no one understands. I guess there was enough morbid curiosity to just barely scrape this song into the top 40 for long enough to make the year-end list. And morbid's a pretty good word for it, because this is a dark, dark song. And I'm not talking about dark because it's about a beloved childhood character going on a killing spree. Honestly, the lyrics here are utter nonsense. That nigga moving, he came with the farm. You can hear nigga laugh with the honor. Time move, nigga bow wanna. You can hit down the bow, summers. No, I mean that this song is eerie, unsettling, and oppressively heavy through its sound alone. And I love it. This is the textbook example of ambient rap, where Designer's flow essentially acts as just another instrument, making this song devoid of meaning, but just a joy to blast out of your car speakers. So much trap music today is just so basic, with most of it following a pretty generic formula. Just create a simple but mildly catchy hook, repeat it throughout the entire song as you rap nonsense over it, jack the bass up to 11, and boom, you're the most successful tentacle hentai this side of the Pacific. Timmy Turner, on the other hand, is one of the most complex and multi-layered trap songs ever to go mainstream, and rather than sounding overcrowded, every layer complements the others, creating a sound that's oddly lush for a song like this. And not only is this a really intricate beat, but it also changes into a completely different beat two-thirds of the way through the song, which is hauntingly beautiful. This is actually really good, and I was expecting it to be a total pile of cringe. So you know what? This song gets the award for the biggest surprise of 2016.
We can now project the winner of the presidential race. CNN projects Donald Trump wins the presidency.
This song gets the award for the second biggest surprise of 2016. Well done, designer. I didn't think you had a great song in you, and you proved me wrong. I guess all I have to do now is write a song about another beloved Nickelodeon character, and I can have a top 40 hit of my own. Let's see. Jimmy Neutron. He be looking for a crouton to give his friend Carl, who's sad because he just lost his croissant. Oh my god, I get to go with this. Timmy 2016 is going to be remembered as the year of a lot of things. It'll be remembered as the year of the most tedious and depressing presidential election in U.S. history. It'll be remembered as the year where beloved celebrities were dropping dead like mayflies. It'll be remembered as the year that the hottest memes were a pair of featureless white shoes and a dead gorilla. However, I think 2016 will also be remembered as the year when everybody came to a gradual but definite realization. Shit. I guess we have to like the Chainsmokers now. Out of all the musical acts to become popular in the past few years who aren't sex offenders, which is a disgustingly low percentage by the way, the Chainsmokers are the most punchable of them. They can't sing, their songs are stuffed with weird electronic effects, they developed a personality as the kings of the frat boys, and they got popular off of this.
But first, let me take a selfie.
I distinctly remember Casey showing me selfie a few years ago when he had downloaded it onto his iPod. And mind you, this was before I hit him in the head with a book repeatedly, so he had no excuse for this. As I cringed my way through the song, I remember looking at the graphic and seeing the guys who made it were called the Chainsmokers, and thinking that A, this was a perfect name for these witless idiots, and B, I would never have to think about them again. And the sad thing is, everything that made them so hateable in those songs is still not only in their songs, it's front and center. They still use weird electronic effects, they're still the kings of the frat boys, and they still can't sing. At all. And yet, despite this, you may have also noticed that every single one of their hit songs, except Don't Let Me Down, has appeared as an honorable mention on one of my best lists. And here I am, naming Roses as one of my favorite songs of 2016. Is it because of Roses, the featured artist who shares her name with this song, but for some reason spells her name with a
C?
Well, yes, I do like her bit a lot, but honestly, this isn't her song. This is the Chainsmokers' song. Her vocal melody is very nice, but it's just one of the many audio tracks of the Chainsmokers mixed together on this song, and the production is the main catch here. The drop isn't just a static riff like other Chainsmokers songs. It lasts a bit longer and spends that time morphing, evolving, and growing. It feels more natural and less mechanical because of this, and it gives the entire song a very cozy feel. This is helped by This is helped by Roses' lyrics, which are small in scope but sweet with intimacy. We could waste a night with an old film, smoke a little weed on the couch in the bathroom, hide away. I don't know how the Chainsmokers managed to take a single note repeated ad infinitum and infuse it with so much passion and life, but I feel it. This is just an incredibly likable song, and the only reason it isn't any higher is because I do like the drop, but I don't love it. It's the best Chainsmokers drop of 2016, but considering its competition, that really isn't saying much. Damn it, Chainsmokers, I really want to punch you guys. Please stop making music I like so we can get to that point. One rule that I have for these lists is that if there's a song that appears on more than one year-end list, then I have to put it on the list where it charted higher. This is, for example, the reason that I didn't put Paralyzer on my Best of 2007 list, even though it would have easily made the top 5 if I did. This is also why I didn't talk about Havana, Rockstar, or I Get the Bag on the 2016 list, because I'm pretty sure they're going to be higher on the 2018 list than they were on the 2017 list. The one exception to this so far has been Thunder, which I talked about on the 2017 Worst list. I didn't realize that it's probably going to be in the year-end top 20 for 2018 because I assumed that our universe was a just and reasonable one worth living in. I was proven wrong. However, I decided that I'm going to break this rule of mine, because there was one song that was bigger in 2017 than it was in 2016, but I totally forgot to give it a spot on my 2017 list. So I'm going to give this song a spot on here, because it definitely deserves it. Or, as the singer of this song might say, it's earned it. Yep. Switch on my core if I kill any pain. Look what you got. I'm a motherfucking star boy. At a glance, it might seem strange that I forgot this song on my 2017 list, considering how iconic it was and still is. I mean, hell, it was a number one hit. The first number one hit of 2017, for that matter, so how did I miss it? Well, it's because I honestly consider this song much more of a 2016 song than a 2017 song. 2016 was completely dominated by a cloud of anxiety and gloom, and if there's one artist who I associate with gloom and darkness, it's The Weeknd. The entire point of this song was how Abel was completely mentally unprepared to be vaulted into superstardom, and how his mental anxiety over losing his own sense of personal identity due to the opulent lifestyle he now leads is driving him to the verge of a mental breakdown. This song couldn't be more flagrantly 2016 if it balanced a fidget spinner on a glowing 1,000-degree knife while wearing a MAGA hat. This is a collaboration between The Weeknd and Daft Punk, one of two off The Weeknd's most recent album, and also the second to make one of my year-end lists. I struggled to pick which song I liked better, Starboy or I Feel It Coming, but I leaned towards Starboy for two reasons. One, that percussion. My mama a crib and a brand new wagon. Now she hit the grocery shop looking lavish. It's so simple and yet so effective. It just makes the whole thing so much tighter. The other thing is that while Starboy and I Feel It Coming are both throwbacks in their own right, Starboy is a throwback in a much different way that I honestly didn't even realize until I really thought about it. Been looking forward to the future. Where my eyesight is going back. Yeah, Starboy is basically The Weeknd doing a Fall Out Boy song. What do I mean by that? Well, a fellow critic of mine commented on my Best of 2007 list and dubbed Fall Out Boys as the masters of the word salad, and I don't think I can put it better than that. Fall Out Boy's whole shtick is that they put together phrases of complete nonsense that really don't mean anything, but they just sound so awesome that you don't care. Let's be honest, do you really care what Pete Wentz means when he blurts out, "This ain't a scene, it's a goddamn face"? No, you don't, because it sounds awesome. In a similar vein, be honest. Do you really care what The Weeknd is saying here? Do you even know or care that Starboy is actually Jamaican slang for someone cool and successful? Have you ever spent an hour looking at the Lyrics Genius page of this song, trying to take these disconnected phrases and stretch them to some sort of meaningful, cohesive whole? No, you haven't. You just like it when Daft Punk use their cool robot voices and go, and then The Weeknd says, "I'm a motherfucking Starboy." Yes, you are, Abel. Excellent delivery, excellent production, and all-around excellent song. Here's to hoping that one day you get selected by a sentient black rectangle from the far-off reaches of space to become the next evolution of mankind. Because if this species is going to evolve into something new, I'd be totally okay with The Weeknd being the starting point.
I'm a motherfucking star boy.
Guys, listen. I just turned 21 years old. I'm going to be a senior in college next year. I'm going to be starting a new book series soon, which is going to take me away from the series that gave me my legs and made me successful in the first place. I have so many questions about my life and where it's going and what I'm going to be doing with myself in the next few years, so please, just let me have this one. I was stressed out. Wish we could turn back time to the good old days when the mama sang us to sleep. But now we're stressed out. 21 Pilots are weird to me. By which I mean, I feel like I should absolutely adore these guys, and yet I find myself only just liking them at best. They had 3 hits this year, and my opinions of them are, well, let's say, mixed. I liked Ride perfectly fine the first few times I heard it, but now I think I'm gonna blow my brains out if I ever have to hear that friggin' song again. Meanwhile, Heathens was one of my final cuts from this list, even though I adored it up until very recently. I don't know what it is about 21 Pilots that prevents their songs from appealing to me long term, but if I had to guess, I'd say it was their production, which always has some element in it that grates on me. For Ride, it's the chorus, which... So I'm taking my time! Well, enough said. I'm taking my time! For Heathens, it was the high-pitched voice that mirrors Tyler's voice throughout the entire thing, which I noticed for the first time a few months ago and have not been able to unnotice ever since. You're welcome, by the way. However, not only does this problem not affect Stressed Out, whose production perfectly matches the tone that the lyrics are trying to convey, but those lyrics... Well, I'm not gonna mince words. They may very well be the single most relatable set of lyrics I've ever heard. I was told when I get older all my fears would shrink, but now I'm insecure and I care what people think. I don't know who in their right mind thought it would be a good idea to tell kids that their insecurities would go away as they get older, because your childhood years are the most innocent time in your life, where you don't have a care in the world that extends outside your own little bubble. Growing up has this way of taking things that you used to like about yourself and weaponizing them against you, not only making you hate those things, but feeling stupid that you ever liked them in the first place. That very well may be my own social anxiety talking, but to be fair, Tyler's anxieties talk to him too, in the form of a character called Blurry Face within the song. My name's Blurry Face and I care what you think. He responds to this by remembering the times in his life when nothing really mattered. But it would remind us of when nothing really mattered. Out of student loans and treehouse homes, we all would take the ladder. With some puns mixed in, this man truly is my own personal hero. The second verse in particular strikes a real chord with me. Sometimes a certain smell will take me back to when I was young. How come I'm never able to identify where it's coming from? I'd make a candle out of it if I ever found it. Try to sell it, never sell out of it. I'd probably only sell one. Maybe to my brother, because we have the same nose, same clothes, homegrown, a stone's throw from a creek we used to roam. That is just so true. I do associate various places and activities in my past with certain smells that mean nothing to anybody who didn't share the same formative experience as I did. I think that's what I like about 21 Pilots. In every song they do, they have this tendency of putting these unspoken truths to word. Death inspires me like a dog inspires a rabbit. You know what? Yeah, life is short and death is terrifying. Let's get as far as we possibly can before it catches up to us. I die for you, that's easy to say. We have a list of people that we would take. A bullet for them, a bullet for you, a bullet for everybody in this room. But they don't seem to see many bullets coming through. See many bullets coming through. Metaphorically, I'm the man, but literally, I don't know what I do. You know what? Yeah, anybody can just say they're gonna die for you, but are they actually gonna do it? Let's hope we never have to find out. I'm driving here, I sit, cursing my government for not using my taxes to fill holes with more cement. You know what? Yeah, we give the government so much money, so why the hell are there still potholes everywhere? This is ludicrous. The government has failed. Yay, anarchy. Let's go commit some crime. I got a ticket for jaywalking. Being an adult sucks. We fly far away. Used to dream of outer space, but now they're laughing at the face saying, wake up, you need to make money. Yeah. Considering that Coldplay has been a presence in the pop scene for about 15 years now, it's kind of astonishing how frequently I forget that they exist. That's not to say that I dislike Coldplay exactly, I just think they have a very low novelty to intrigue ratio. As a band, their sound is constantly changing and evolving, but it's still recognizably Coldplay, and I'm sorry, but Coldplay at their base just isn't that interesting. They're just a moodier, downbeat, and less fun version of cooler rock bands, and honestly, even calling them a rock band is stretching the definition of rock right up to the line. That said, I have noticed a pattern between the Coldplay songs that I like. Each of them have Coldplay trying out something unique to set them apart from the glut of easy-listening soft rock schlock they usually pump out. A nice piano loop in a 3-3-2 pattern years before Rihanna beat that rhythm into the ground? Well, that's a good start. I want something just like this. Some really nice electronic build-up courtesy of the Chainsmokers? Alright, not bad. Bringing on Rihanna as a Chinese princess, taking advantage of the last few years that you could do that without getting yelled at for cultural appropriation? Valiant effort, but I know that you can do better than that. An epic story about the hubris of human nature portrayed through the rise and fall of a medieval king, chock full of references to ancient literature and iconography with one of the most beautiful and timeless sounds in any song I've ever heard? Factum bene, Fregues Ludere. I guess what I'm saying here is that Coldplay is the musical equivalent of Kirby. In order to get anything done, they need to try different things by absorbing unusual things into their body. Otherwise, they just suck. So come on, Coldplay, tell me. What unique, interesting element did you bring to the table in 2016 that I've never seen from you before? The most terrifyingly uncanny CGI monkeys this side of Jumanji. Seems legit. But come alive again. Technically speaking, this song was released in the waning days of 2015, and in retrospect, that seems almost prophetic because this song bridges the gap between 2015 and 16 immaculately. The funky production and upbeat energy of this song fit in well with the 2015 pop scene, while the minor key and Chris Martin's long, extended syllables also lend to an almost ethereal element to the song, which fits more into the gloom of 2016. I joked about the terrifying music video, which I will address further in a moment, but for now, let's just talk about that riff. I don't know what combination of instruments and effects were used to create that little snippet of music, but it sounds absolutely incredible, and oh boy do they milk it. Half of the song is just that riff and nothing else, and that's the half of the song that I adore. The other half is Martin singing, which, I mean, I like it better than most of Coldplay stuff because of the upbeat tempo and the production that drives it, but the lyrics aren't anything to write home about. I mean, maybe it's just a matter of imbalance. That riff is so amazing that all the parts without it seem almost naked by comparison. This part at the end where Martin sings over the riff is easily the highlight of the song. Ordinarily, I would be totally down for giving a woohoo in response, but that might alert my presence to the nightmare creatures on screen, and I'm afraid that might cause them to leap off the screen and eat me. I'm not gonna rag on the animation for too much longer, since it's an old joke by this point, but I do feel the need to point out that this video apparently had the same budget as a mid-tier Hollywood movie, took 6 months to make, was overseen by the king of motion capture, Andy Serkis, was made by the same people who did the special effects for the Planet of the Apes, Avengers, and Star Wars movies, and the end product is comparable to the animated monkey emoji on iPhone X. So congratulations, Coldplay. You've made a song that's half decent and half mind-blowingly incredible, complete with some of the most uncanny CGI I've ever seen in my life. You made the Rogue One of songs.
listen to some music with the message like we usually do. And we'll discuss our big dreams, how we plan to take over the planet. So how